In God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. A few years ago, I was acting in an episode of a TV series that was about politics, set in Washington, D.C. And the writing in this show, unusual for TV, was especially very good. The scripts were done by a very well-known writer, a smart, literate guy who was very savvy about government and life in general. But there was one point in the episode that I was in which he had one of the central characters say, they were talking about poverty. And one of the characters said, Jesus says, if you're a rich person, you're never going to make it into heaven. He was very clear about that. And the way it was framed in the show, the person was obviously supposed to be telling the truth. There are sort of truth tellers in all fiction. Well, actually, that's a misunderstanding. It's always nice to hear Jesus quoted and taken seriously in popular culture, but this is a misunderstanding. Plainly, the writer was referring to the story that we heard today about the rich man who comes to Jesus. Although he was quoting from the story as it is in the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus talks about the kingdom of heaven as opposed to the kingdom of God, as in Mark, which we heard today. Those two terms are interchangeable. They mean the same thing for Jesus. Plainly, this writer understood the kingdom of heaven to mean simply heaven. That is, that place where we go, hopefully, when we die. And he took it for granted that everybody who knows the gospel story understands that the same way, and that that's the Christian position about people who are rich. Well, clearly this was a teaching moment for me on this studio set, but I managed to restrain myself. Everybody had a job to do, like me. But as Christians, we need continually to refresh ourselves in our understanding of what Jesus meant when he was talking about the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. That was the basis of his mission, the proclamation that the kingdom of God is at hand. It's the first thing he says in the Gospel of Mark. It's especially important to talk about what this means in connection with this story that we heard today, a story which over the course of church history has probably made more people more uncomfortable than any other story in the gospel, as it did the disciples. I'm not going to try to make it any less uncomfortable. I don't want to. I can't. But I will try to suggest a way to approach it. The story we heard today is in two parts, Jesus with the rich man, and then Jesus with the disciples talking about what just happened. The man runs up to Jesus and asks him a question about eternal life. In what he says and does, it's clear that this man is spirit-filled, he's sincere, he's devout, and Jesus, looking on him, loves him, Mark tells us, which the Gospels rarely say about Jesus. It may be that Jesus loves him because he knows he has to lower the boom on this guy. He has to tell him, set a standard that he knows this guy's not going to be able to meet. Jesus tells him, you lack one thing. Go sell everything you have. And you'll have treasures in heaven. And give it to the poor. And then come follow me. Well, how would you react? How would any of us react if Jesus said that? I mean, it occurred to me, I would probably try to talk him out of it. I would say, look, I got a better idea. But this man has the faith to take Jesus seriously. And he has the faith, the integrity, to be shocked, Mark tells us, and to walk away grieving. We don't know what happened to this man. The story just, the dilemma is left hanging there for us to deal with. That's the first part of the story. The second part is Jesus talking with the disciples about what they just saw, what was really at stake for everybody involved. And Jesus is quite clear that it has to do with what he calls entering the kingdom of God. The first thing he says to them, if they're watching a man walk away, it's not about the inherent evil of money or of having possessions. He says how hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. Entering the kingdom of God is the focus. Wealth is just an obstacle. It's a big obstacle, but just an obstacle. That's the opposite of the traditional Old Testament conception, in which wealth was a sign, a sure sign, of God's favor. That's Job's problem in reading from Job. He can't believe God is there anymore because someone has taken all his possessions. And he knows he hasn't done anything wrong. Entering the kingdom of God, what does that mean? Here's my attempt at that. It means trying to live life, really live it day in and day out, minute by minute, in the awareness that the Almighty and Eternal God, the Creator of the universe, that same God is alive and active all the time in this world that we live in, living in the knowledge that that God loves each one of us, cares about what we do, and is constantly inviting us to join in God's work every day to restore love, peace, and joy throughout God's creation. God is continually putting before us opportunities to do that if we just open our eyes. That's entering the kingdom of God. It's hard to do that. It's hard to live that way because we're human beings, which means, among other things, that we're flawed and we're limited. And we get tired. And the world is a flawed, chaotic place. I think in these circumstances, it's actually very comforting to hear Jesus say this, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It confirms wonderfully what we heard today from the letter to the Hebrews. We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but who has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Jesus says how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God and how really hard it is for the wealthy. In Mark, he says to the man, you lack one thing, one thing. In another translation of the story, he says, if you wish to go the whole way, go sell everything you have and give to the poor and come follow me. In this story, Jesus says three times how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. First, the third time, he specifically mentions wealth as the difficulty. But sandwiched in between those two, he just says how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. And it's not just for the rich, but for any of us. The disciples understand it this way. That's why when Jesus says it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who's rich to enter the kingdom of God, they look at each other and say, well, then who can be saved? They know that it's not just the rich. It's all of us. Why is it so much harder for the rich? Why does Jesus put it nigh unto impossible? Wealth can be a narcotic. Some people, the more they have, the more they want, and it's never enough. And much more commonly, wealth can anesthetize us to the real life that's going on all around us. As long as your needs are being satisfied and even catered to, hey, no problem. I'm fine. Such people don't get or deserve much sympathy from any of us. Jesus is dealing in this story with a good man who's kept all the commandments all his life and wants to do better. So what's his problem? Why is wealth in his way? Well, we tend to define ourselves by what we have, by the marks of our life, the physical identifiers. And the more we accumulate, the more those we accrue to ourselves, the worse it gets, because the spark of the Holy Spirit that lives in us and that gives us life gets lost. It gets smothered in the pursuit of things. Things that we think we have to have for our family, not even for ourselves, but there's still the things that we feel like we have to go after. This is how we isolate ourselves from God and from the kingdom of God. Jesus talked more about money, wealth, possessions in the Gospels than he did about any other subject. In the Sermon on the Mount, he says, don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth. Don't store up, don't accumulate. Because that stuff just rots away and other people steal it. And it's gone, meaningless. It was never really yours in the first place. But store up treasures in heaven, that is, treasures of the Spirit, which don't rust and don't rot, which give life, and which no one can take away from you. And Jesus concludes with a profound insight into human nature, this little passage. He says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. What we put value on, that's where our spirit goes. It's a warning, and it's an invitation. We can go two ways. In this life, we're always growing, we're always evolving, and in the freedom that God gives us, what we choose to do with the life that God gives us affects that growth. We move ourselves in a particular direction. But not everyone defines themselves by their possessions. Some do it by their fear. Some do it by their anger. they're outraged. That list is infinite, but there is only one direction in which we can look to find who we truly are. When the disciples ask, who then can be saved, the answer is, of course, none of us, under our own power. This isn't just a story about the 1%. If we treat it that way, we're letting ourselves off the hook. We all live in this material world. We're all part of it. So we can never, in this life, fully enter the kingdom of God. We know that. There will always be that infinite chasm between ourselves and God. But Jesus says, for mortals, this is impossible to bridge that chasm. But for God, all things are possible. And God reaches across that chasm, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, enables us to live honest lives in the knowledge of our limitations and the knowledge of God's presence with us. When we think about money and we think about what we possess, if we hold that as our primary focus, then we get stuck. We get mired. The spirit is lost and life grinds to a halt. But if we can keep at the center of our attention, entering the kingdom of God, living that way, then as we heard Jesus say today, we will receive hundredfold in this age and in the age to come, eternal life. That's the answer to the rich man. He says, how do I get eternal life? Jesus says, strive first for the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given to you as well. Strive, he says. It's hard, but it's the truth. Thanks be to God.